All right, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 19 of quantum mechanics part one. So most of you, all of you will probably be coming back to campus very soon. I think that's good. We'll have offline classes and offline exam, and I'm sure all of you are very excited. I can't wait to take offline exams. Isn't that right, Priya? Okay, so today we'll talk about time evolution of quantum states. Okay, now let me turn off the sound. So obviously, any theory of physics should tell us about change, right? So it should be able to tell us how a state changes over time, right? Of course, there's also this question of what is time. That's a separate, entirely different question. So we'll just put that aside. Right? We'll assume that there is a global time variable. Pritam, please mute yourself. Thanks. Right, so we'll assume that there's a global time variable, and we can label all quantum states using this variable. Right. So now we want to understand how to describe dynamics. Right? So dynamics is determined by the Hamiltonian, right? By the Schrodinger equation. So this is the Schrodinger equation, right? The solution of this Schrodinger, of this equation, you can actually solve it explicitly. And you get the following. Expression as a solution. Okay, what is this U? This is an operator, right? It has to be an operator, obviously, because it relates the state at an earlier time to a state at a later time. And so it's a unitary operator, and it has to be unitary in order for the dynamics to preserve probabilities, right? And of course, we are assuming here that T prime is less than T, but that is not necessary. We'll see that T prime can also be greater than T, right? So you can talk about going backwards in time, right? You can do that in classical physics also. It's not something very mysterious. And we can write down the formal expression for this as follows. Okay, and now I'm running out of primes. So this is the unitary operator. Here I'm assuming that that my Hamiltonian might have some time dependence. right? So you can check that that this is a solution of Schrodinger equation. You can do that by differentiating with respect to t. Yeah. With respect to time. Okay. And from the form of this operator, it is an exponential of the imaginary I multiplied by this object, which is a Hermitian operator, right? So H is Hermitian. So if you take exponent I H, this will be unitary, right? Again, that's easy to check, and you should do that. So this is a unitary operator, right? If your Hamiltonian is time independent, then of course this integral will become a definite integral, right? It will just become h times delta t, where delta t is this t minus t prime, right? And so in this case, psi of t is just going to be equal to exponent minus I by h bar. I'll put delta t before and then h. And then psi t prime. Okay. Now, so this is a unitary operator, right? So what is the inverse of this unitary operator? The inverse is, since it's unitary, it's the Hermitian conjugate, right? But since this is time evolution, that should be the same as saying that we are going from t prime to t, right? So evolving backwards in time, right? Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Can some of you please turn your videos on, because I have no idea whether I'm audible, whether you can hear me. I have absolutely no reactions from anybody. So thank you, RT. Thank you very much. And some few other people also turn their videos on to accompany her. So obviously, if you take psi of t and you multiply it by by the inverse of this unitary operator, right, you get the, you get back to the state from which you started. Okay. So let's look at a very simple example of how this time evolution acts on some state. So we'll consider as an example, let's consider our good friend, the infinite potential. Right. So we know what our states are. They are labeled by some number, integer n, and they look like this, right? Given that our potential has this form, right? So our well is located between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, right? And n is a positive integer, okay? So what happens if I consider the state psi of n at some time t is equal to 0? Okay, and well, what is the state? It's just this object. Fine. And then I ask, well, what is it at some later time? Right. So exponent minus I by h bar, integral from 0 to t. Right? And this is the Hamiltonian, right? But we know that our Hamiltonian for the infinite potential well, right? What is the Hamiltonian? V squared by 2m plus V of x, right? We know that this is time independent, right? So this integral is trivial, right? So you just get psi n t exponent minus I by h bar delta t h psi n zero, okay? And now we can ask, well, what is, how can we evaluate this, right? And the answer is yes, you can. Right. So if you have the exponential of some operator and it acts on some state and you want to evaluate this, how can you do that? Well, you can expand. You can perform this series expansion of your exponential, right? And then each term in the series will act on the state. So this will become right. For this Hamiltonian, you remember that these are eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. Right? right? So if phi is an eigenstate of this operator A, right? Then what will this object be? A to the power k acting on phi. This will be just the eigenvalue to the power k multiplied by phi. Right? And so this sum here will become lambda k times phi by k factorial, right? And what is this? This is just exponent of lambda. So what happens to this? Here you just get minus I by h bar delta t, right? And you can replace this operator over here. You can replace this operator h in this quantity by the eigenvalue of h acting on the state. So that eigenvalue is e of n, right? So this is our answer for the time evolution of one of these eigenstates. Okay. Now, one second, let me just try to change the settings a little bit so that okay. Now, so what this tells us is that psi of nt is equal to exponent minus I over h bar. And so we can write it as exponent minus I omega t psi n. Okay. What is, and I'll put n on this omega, what is omega n? Omega n is this quantity en divided by h bar. Right? So this is just Planck's relationship, right? The energy is equal to h bar multiplied by omega, right? Omega is related to the frequency by two pi f, right? So h bar omega is equal to hf is equal to e, right? So this is just Planck's relationship. So what this is telling us is that our state is just being multiplied by a complex phase. That's it. Right? So nothing really is happening, so to speak. Because the complex phase really has no observable consequences. So we refer to such states, right? These are called stationary states, right? So stationary states are eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. And why do we call them stationary? Well, because if you ask, for instance, and I was being a little bit sloppy here, so let me fix my sloppy notation. So when I write this psi of n, I should write it like this. N pi x over L ket x dx, right? Because this is a vector, right? Psi of n. So you have to write it as, if you're working in the position basis, you have to write the vector in terms of its components, its position components, right? So psi of x is the position component, and that's equal to this root 2 by L times the sine, right? Now, when you refer to books like Zettelli and also Griffiths and others, you won't find this bracket notation, right? You'll just encounter something like this. Right? So this is without the Dirac notation. Okay. But the result is the same, right? Because here what I'm doing is I'm multiplying each component, each position component, by the same factor, right? So the result is the same, right? That just corresponds to multiplying everything by the same exponential factor. Right? If I multiply each component by the same factor, that just multiplies the whole state by that factor, right? Okay. So when can we get something? So why are these called stationary states? Well, they're stationary because if you ask what is the probability density, right? What is the probability density? The probability density is psi of x t squared. This is the probability density, right? It is the probability of finding the particle at the location x plus minus some small delta x dx, right? Some infinitesimal amount t. So if we evaluate this, right, what do we get? This is just a complex phase. This object is just a complex phase, right? So we will just get that the probability density, it remains constant over time for a stationary state, right? So if we, for instance, plot the probability density, let's say for the ground state, right? It will just look like this. This is the probability density for the ground state. Sine square pi x by L times 2 by L, right? This is a probability density. The state itself is not time independent. Why? Because the state has is being multiplied by a complex factor here, right? So the state is has a time dependence. But the probability of finding the location at any point does not change over time, right? So now we can consider like something is slightly less trivial, right? This is no fun. It doesn't give us anything. It's very, very boring, right? There is nothing is happening, so to speak. So how do we get non-stationary states? Right. So what is it? Well, we can just consider some superposition. Of our stationary eigenstates, right? So these guys here these are our stationary eigenstates. Right? But this is not an eigenstate of your Hamiltonian. So let's ask what will be the time evolution of this state phi. Right? So phi of t is going to be the same thing minus ih bar. TH by zero. Okay. Now, we ask what happens when you take, right? Earlier we had this. I explained what happens if you take an exponential, right, and act on some state, right? And if that state is an eigenstate, right, then you get this result, but if it's not an eigenstate, then what will happen? So if it's a superposition of two eigenstates like this, phi 1 plus phi 2, right? What will happen? Well, you'll get e to the power lambda 1 psi 1 e to the power lambda 2 psi 2, right? That operator will act separately on both of those states. You can just look at this expansion, right, of the exponential operator and act on your state, which is a superposition of psi 1 and psi 2, you'll get two terms, right? Lambda 1 to the power k plus lambda 2 to the power k. So in our case, what will be this phi of t? Right? So phi of t will be alpha 1 e to the minus I omega 1 t psi 1 0 plus alpha 2 e to the power minus I omega 2 t psi 2 0. right? So what is omega 1? En E1 by h bar omega 2, right, is E2 by h bar, and omega 1 is not equal to omega 2, right? So as time progresses, these two components, they start to develop a phase difference, right? So we can write this expression in the following way. We can write it as exponent minus I omega 1 t. I can take this factor common. Psi 1 0. Then exponent, I can put this exponent in the second term. I get minus omega t like this. Times psi 2 0 like this, right? So I can write this as e to the power minus I omega 1 t alpha 1 psi 1 naught plus e to the power I minus I delta omega t, right? Delta omega is omega 2 minus omega 1. Right? And now you can see that this object, this number, is the phase difference. Right? So whenever you have a phase difference, that phase difference tells you something about the interference pattern, right? And so if you have constructive interference or destructive interference, depends on the value of the phase, right? So now we can ask, for instance, what happens to the probability distribution, the probability density, the position of the state phi as a function of time, right? So, well, what is that going to be? P of xt is going to be phi xt squared like this, right? And what is phi xt squared? So we have this complex term outside. This will just cancel. And what you will get, let me here, is the following. So we'll get alpha 1 star psi 1 x star plus e to the I delta omega t alpha 2 star psi 2 star, right? Now I'm working with the components, you can see, right? So this is phi star, right? Phi star x times alpha 1 psi 1 x e to the minus I delta omega t alpha 2 psi 2, right? And it's understood that that is psi of 2 x, at the initial time. Okay. And so when we expand these terms, right, what will we get? We'll get alpha 1 squared psi 1 x squared alpha 2 squared psi 2 x squared, right? But then something interesting will happen from the cross terms. What will we get? We will get, let's look at the cross terms. We'll get alpha 1 star alpha 2 e to the pi minus I delta omega t psi 1 star x psi 2 x right plus the complex conjugate. Right, so CC, this CC, it means complex conjugate. Okay. So when you take the complex conjugate, what do you get? You get some Z, so Z plus. So if you take some Z plus Z star, what do you get? You get right? Sorry, I'm a bit of a perfectionist when it comes to my corners. So this whole thing will become the probability density, phi of xt squared, right? It will become, well, copy and paste this. Paste, we get this. Plus, two times RE, right? The real part of the real part of this complex number, right? So that real part will contain a contribution from the exponential phase. What will be the real part of the exponential? It will be cosine delta omega t. Right? And then you can write down the rest, the real part of this alpha 1, alpha 2. Right? Well, and since psi 1 and psi 2 are real, I can just write that as psi 1 x and psi 2 x because these are real, right? Times RE. Alpha 1, alpha 2. Okay. So what do we find? We find that this term, it is generating interference between psi 1 and psi 2. Right? So a probability density is no longer a constant. It's a function of time, right? It oscillates and you can ask what is the minimum and maximum value of this probability density, right? So psi of xt squared, when will it be minimum, right? It will be minimum when this cosine delta omega t is equal to minus 1, right? And it will be maximum when this cosine delta omega t is equal to plus 1, right? Because all the other terms, these two terms, these are positive definite, right? They're either positive, they're either greater than 0 or at worst equal to 0. So it is only this term and the sign of this term which determines whether right, this guy has a minimum or a maximum. Right? And so when does this happen? When do you get cosine delta omega t is equal to 1? Right? This will happen when t, when delta omega times t is what? 2 and pi, right? And when will it be minus 1? It will be minus 1 for 2n plus 1 pi, right? Yes, for cosine, for n is equal to, for the, when the argument is 0 or 2 pi or 4 pi, then cosine is plus 1. Otherwise, for when argument is pi or 3 pi or 5 pi, a cosine is minus 1. Right? So you will get a probability density, right, which oscillates. And what is the period of oscillation? Well, it will correspond to this delta omega, right? So the period of oscillation is when delta omega t is equal to 2 pi. So this tells us that the time period will be 2 pi by delta omega. Okay. So this is a very simple example of a time dependent Hamiltonian, not a Hamiltonian, sorry, time dependent, the evolution of a system with some time, non-trivial time dependence, right? So stationary states are those states which whose probability density doesn't change with time. So time evolution is given by a unitary operator, right? And that for a time independent Hamiltonian, that unitary operator is simple to determine. And the action on eigenstates is just given by a complex phase. It doesn't change the probability density. But if you take superpositions of eigenstates, different eigenstates, you get a non-stationary state, and the probability density associated with that non-stationary state, right, undergoes oscillations which are determined by this factor cosine omega delta omega t, right? Okay. All right, so I'll stop here for today, and ask if you have any questions, and you can ask me any questions if you have any. But in the meantime, let me just go back to this question from the mid-sem, the Dirac delta potential. And what I had done here was, right, I had performed this integration in order to try to understand more how to deal with this delta function, right? I formed this integration. So here I was basically on the right track, right? But what was my mistake? My mistake was that instead of taking the integral from x is equal to minus infinity to infinity, see, we are not interested in the behavior of the state over here. Okay. We're not interested in the behavior of the state in this part, right? Here we know what it does. Here also we know what it does. The non-trivial part of the potential is precisely at the origin, right? So if we want to understand how to what happens at the origin, what we have to do is we have to perform the integration and in some interval around the origin. And then we have to take the limit that epsilon goes to zero. Okay. So when you do this, what you find is when you do this integration, what you'll find is you will get from this term, when you integrate this term, you will get something like d by dx of psi. And so when you take this limit, when you take these the limits of integration, epsilon and minus epsilon, and you subtract those two, what you will get is you will get the difference between the derivative of the state psi in this region, in region 2, and minus the derivative in this region, region 1. Now you can see that once you get to the origin, the state itself is continuous, right? But the derivative of the state is not continuous, right? So this is the derivative on one side is positive, on the other side is negative, right? So it's discontinuous. The derivative is discontinuous. That discontinuity in the derivative is determined by this term, the size of the potential. And here there are two numbers, but we don't need two numbers. That's redundant. You can always multiply, get rid of one of those, right? Okay, so I'll stop here for the day and let you all go to your next class. But if you have any questions, you are welcome to stick around, okay? And ask those questions. Okay, bye-bye.
Okay, so thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Questions? Any questions? No? Sorry? Hello?